How's it going? Hey, how's it going? My name is Mal. I have a lot to say about the Halloween franchise, probably too much to go in any one video, but for now, I just want to focus on preparing for Halloween Ends, which is coming out this fall, by looking through some of the ideas at play in the earlier movies. And I'm hoping to finally work through my feelings about Halloween Kills, which came out last year. If you are new to the franchise, that's fine. I'm going to go through a summary of all of the movies so far, and then we'll add some more detail later as needed. Okay, quick note. So this was originally going to be one long video. It's now two videos. This part is just going to be the recap, and then everything I'm talking about in the introduction is actually going to be in part two. Okay, thank you. My aim is really not to be comprehensive or even all that grounded. I want to have fun, and I want to consider fascistic myth-making in our media. So, let's go. I'm going to take these movies seriously, both because it's a lot more fun that way, and because this new iteration of movies really asks to be taken seriously.
Well, the system failed.
The new series presents itself as a comment on its contemporary moment, but the way a film reflects a time is dependent on the subjectivities of all involved. So that is not an easy task. John Molnau, in his Dialectics of Art, writes, "It is necessary to remember that art both arises out of and is always conditioned by a definite historical and social context, and represents a specific active human response to that context." On the audience side of things, Harry Benshoff, in The Monster and the Homosexual, writes, "When talking about a cultural product or discursive object, such as a filmic genre system, one would be wise to take into consideration not only the historical discourses of production, where meanings are encoded, but also those of reception, where meanings are decoded according to a multiplicity of different reading positions." So, we have a few avenues down which to follow this franchise. The context the work was created in, how that context was processed through the specific creators of a work, and how that context is then understood by the audience of a work. There's an additional conceptual issue to consider, because the monster at work in Halloween has been taken from its own time, which had its own historical and cultural context, and now functions as a piece of nostalgia. Jeffrey Jerome Cohen codified his ideas about the monster into 7 theses on monster theory, and the final one seems like a good place to start. Monsters are our children. They can be pushed to the farthest margins of geography and discourse, hidden away at the edges of the world and in the forbidden recesses of our mind, but they always return. And when they come back, they bring not just a fuller knowledge of our place in history and the history of knowing our place, but they bear self-knowledge, human knowledge, and a discourse all the more sacred as it arises from the outside. These monsters ask us how we perceive the world and how we have misrepresented what we have attempted to place. They ask us to reevaluate our cultural assumptions about race, gender, sexuality, our perception of difference, our tolerance towards its expression. They ask us why we have created them. I like this as a way to conceptualize what happens every time one of our franchise monsters has died. They've been pushed away for now, but they'll always return with some new outside knowledge. And Michael, as far as monsters go, has made a career of coming back. In some ways, that's been what's identified him throughout the series. The 1978 tagline is "The Night He Came Home." This carries over in the reboot as 40 years later, evil returns home. I want to understand Michael's reason why. Why was he brought back, and what knowledge has he returned with? What does it mean to the filmmakers, to viewers, and to Michael himself to be moved into 2018? Before getting into it, I just want to say that I'm here talking about these movies out of love. I love all of these movies, even the ones that I hate. And I know that there are some takes along the lines of, like, Halloween Kills ruined an icon, but let's all try to keep in mind that Michael's had a long history of being less than dignified. A second disclaimer. It's okay to come out of these movies with different impressions. I mean, they all reflect society as filtered through a creator, transformed into extremes of visceral imagery, which is received through each of our associations with those symbols. A good monster takes on a multiplicity of identities to reflect the disparate and ever-evolving fears and anxieties of us, the viewer. So, it makes sense that different movies work for different people. I mean, my favorite Halloween movie might be H2O, and that is both for grounded, reasonable reasons, and for the fully out of my control factor of being a specific age and finding comfort in the late 90s as a setting. I also am both obsessed with hockey and grew up on Third Rock from the Sun, so I can't help but love that this movie opens with Joseph Gordon-Levitt trying to threaten Michael Myers with his slashing penalty minute stats. So final disclaimer, I'm trash, my taste is trash, I'm very easily amused by hockey references. I don't actually know if liking H2O is a hot take or not. Even though I'm not approaching the 2018 iteration from a place of particularly liking it, I am hoping that by repeated exposure it will grow on me, and over time, I think that these movies will fall into place in this weirdo, super psycho franchise the way other oddballs like 2, 3, 5, 6, 8, and 9, and 10 have. The first Halloween, released in 1978, was directed and written by John Carpenter and produced and written by Deborah Hill, or, as Carpenter apparently nicknamed her, the Queen of Morbid Terror. She told Fangoria, "Carpenter and I have found in working together that the more visually oriented a script is, the least amount of exposition there is, the better that works for us." This narrative simplicity and visual first style will vary greatly throughout the franchise as it moves through directors, decades, and studios. In this original, we start on Halloween night 1963, behind the eyes of a figure watching through the window as a couple makes out. We enter the house after the guy leaves and walk upstairs, picking up a kitchen knife and the clown mask on the way. In the bedroom, the girl is naked and brushing her hair. When she turns around, she recognizes us as her 6-year-old brother Michael, before we stab her to death and walk back downstairs as our parents get home. The clown mask is pulled off, and we freeze frame on Michael Myers and his parents standing outside the Myers home. Michael spends the next 15 years in Smith's Grove Sanitarium, where his doctor, Samuel Loomis, played by Donald Pleasance, cannot get a single word out of him. Michael escapes the night before Halloween, witnessed by Loomis and Nurse Marion Chambers. He returns to his hometown of Haddonfield, where he watches from inside his childhood home, now empty and for sale, as Laurie Strode drops off the house keys. Her father is the realtor trying to sell the house. Loomis and another Dr. Wynn, who will reappear later in the franchise in a very unexpected way, contemplate Michael's escape.
Haddonfield is 150 miles away from here. Now, for God's sakes, he can't drive a car.
He was doing very well last night. Maybe someone around here gave him lessons.
Michael, with said car, spies on Laurie from outside her classroom and checks back in on Tommy at the end of his school day, scaring Tommy's bully, Lonnie Elam. You wouldn't think he's important, but he will be 11 movies from now, so. Michael drives by Laurie and her friends on their way home from school, taking offense when he's yelled at for speeding past. He follows her home. Laurie Strode, Belgian expressionism fan. James Ensor has a gazillion, like, mask and or clown paintings, so presumably not incidental. Her friend Annie Brackett picks her up, and they run into Annie's dad, the sheriff, at Vincent Drug, which has just been broken into.
Well, now all they took was some Halloween mask, rope, and a couple of knives.
The movie, and really the franchise, hinges a lot on Jamie Lee Curtis is Laurie Strode and the audience's engagement with her. As she told Fangoria before the sequel released, John doesn't laboriously work with actors. He hires you for a part he thinks you can do and lets you do. We talked about her vulnerability, and he told me that he wanted the audience to talk to her out loud during the movie, which I thought was completely weird, but sure enough they did. Something this movie gets right that a lot of its copycat films fail at is that Laurie, as played by Jamie Lee Curtis, isn't really the shy girl next door type that she's written as. What makes Laurie Strode so compelling is as much Jamie Lee Curtis's natural hard edge as anything in the script. Curtis, reflecting on the role in 1998, said, "I don't know exactly how I was cast in Halloween. It was luck. I wouldn't pick me as a virginal babysitter. Smart aleck cheerleader maybe, but I don't think I epitomized virginal babysitters." While Laurie babysits Tommy Doyle and Lindsay Wallace, Michael spends the night stalking and killing Laurie's friends. After a concerning phone call, Laurie leaves the kids to check on Annie and finally comes face to face with Michael. She runs, banging on doors in a scene that will be recreated several more times in this franchise, until Tommy lets her back into his house. Michael follows and she fights him off, stabbing him with a knitting needle and a straightened out hanger before Dr. Loomis finds them and shoots Michael. Moments later, the body is gone, and we end on ominous shots of Haddonfield, aware that Michael is out there somewhere. Halloween 2, released in 1981, continues on the same night. It has maybe the best opening in the franchise.
Call the police! Tell the sheriff I shot him!
Who? This is some kind of joke.
I've been trick-or-treated to death tonight.
You don't know what death is.
There's somehow both nothing to say about this movie and an endless number of weird moments to obsess over, so to keep things moving, I'm going to stick just to the basic plot points. Loomis is sure that he shot Michael 6 times.
I shot him six times! This guy!
This is the start of Loomis's true crusade through this franchise, against not just an evil patient, but a supernatural force. Michael wanders through Haddonfield homes, picking up a kitchen knife on his travels, while Laurie is taken away on a stretcher and driven to the hospital, where she arrives at the same time as a little pirate who bit into Halloween candy with a razor blade in it. Lori's put under by a visibly drunk doctor who's been partying at the country club all night with her parents, who are now unreachable.
Janet, get me some more coffee.
And Michael slips into the hospital unnoticed. Jamie Lee Curtis and many fans agree that having her be unconscious for most of this movie is a very weird choice and really weakens it overall. According to Curtis, I even got them to move back the drugging halfway. I used to get drugged as soon as I got to the hospital. She told Femme Fatale years later, "It stinks. It's a terrible, terrible movie." Michael kills hospital staff as Loomis roams Haddonfield and mistakenly kills a kid dressed inexplicably exactly like Michael. Or I guess this is Loomis's fault, but I don't know why the kid exploded like that, so maybe there is something else going on. We learn later that this was unfortunately Ben Tramer.
Yeah, I'm worried about Bennett Tramer.
He isn't home yet.
The kid that Laurie wanted to go to the dance with.
I'd rather go out with Ben Tramer.
Ben Tramer?
After some weird flirting with the EMT, Laurie finally finds out who attacked her.
In the Myers house? The little kid who killed his sister?
And ask the question that will haunt this franchise for the next 4 decades.
Why me?
While asleep, Laurie has some weird dreams. Meanwhile, on a field trip to an elementary school that had been broken into, Loomis collects some clues.
It means the Lord of the Dead, the end of summer, October 31st.
Before Nurse Marion shows up with a marshal to take him back to Smith's Grove by order of the governor.
Patient escapes once, murders 3 teenagers. You shoot him with a gun, he escapes again. This could jeopardize our whole rehabilitation program.
Leaving the school, no one is quite sure what to do with what they've seen.
We'll find him.
Where you gonna look?
I don't know.
Neither do I.
At the hospital, Michael kills his way to Lori's room, but she's tricked him. On the road back to Smith's Grove, Loomis learns that there was a secret file he was never shown. Laurie was adopted and is in fact Michael's younger sister. So Michael's given motive. He is now on a mission, apparently, to kill his sisters. Loomis has the marshal turn back toward the hospital at gunpoint.
What have I got to lose? Except my job.
And Loomis, Michael, and Laurie finally converge. Laurie shoots out Michael's eyes, and as he blindly swipes at her, she escapes and Loomis blows himself and Michael up. Halloween 3, released in 1982, was John Carpenter's attempt to continue his original plan of making the Halloween series an anthology and not based on Michael Myers, and is a fully separate story where the power of Stonehenge is put into these masks, which will turn kids' brains into like snakes and bugs. The audience had already fallen in love with Michael, and this was not well received, but has become kind of a cult classic since. Halloween 4, 5, and 6 are all kind of related, although 4 and 5 are more a piece, and then 6 is like an incomprehensible left turn. Things get really tough around here because I'm going to want to show you every wild moment, but most of it really doesn't matter to understanding any kind of like overarching ideas going on in this franchise. I'll try to ignore all the places where I want to say, look at this wild blank. Halloween 4, released in 1988. Follows Jamie Lloyd, the daughter of now-dead Laurie Strode, as she develops a connection to her uncle Michael Myers. She lives in Haddonfield with her adoptive family 11 months after the car crash that killed Laurie. Michael is being taken back to Smith's Grove from a federal facility where he's been in a coma for the last 10 years following the explosion at the end of Halloween 2. The star of the movie, this security guard, gives us a good summary of the story so far.
A decade ago, Halloween night, he murdered 16 people, maybe more, trying to get to his sister. But his doctor, of all people, shot him. Then he set him on fire. Both of them nearly burned to death. I'd be glad to see this one gone. Yes, indeedy.
We get insight into what Loomis's colleagues think of him.
Loomis Red Mammals, he'd be here.
My hope is that he'll either transfer, retire, or die.
During the transfer, comatose Michael learns from the doctors that he has a niece, and he immediately wakes up and resumes killing. A lot of fans have really strong opinions about the mask as it changes through each movie. I will admit that I usually don't really notice the mask, but I will say when I was looking through old magazine articles that this spread in Gore Zone really makes you notice how unthreatening this one is. This may have to do with production having had very little time to finish anything in this movie. Larry Fiorito, special effects coordinator, is quoted as saying, "Most of the mayhem in this film is only going to be seen after the fact, because there just wasn't the time to do it." Anyway, Jamie's been seeing a nightmare man the last few nights and not sleeping. She's also worried that her adoptive family doesn't love her, and her sister Rachel struggles a bit to say the right things.
Do you love me, Rachel?
Of course I love you.
Like a sister?
Times
like a real sister?
We're not really sisters, Jamie.
Loomis finally hears about the transfer and is on Michael's trail. They cross paths at a gas station where Michael is stopped to acquire his preferred wardrobe. Michael escapes in an explosion that downs the phone lines, leaving Loomis to hitchhike to Haddonfield.
Come on, old man, let's go!
He has mixed luck.
Get it in gear, old man!
We're all on a quest. Sometimes we need help getting where we want to be. Yeah, you're hunting it, all right. Apocalypse, end of the world, Armageddon. It's always got a face and a name.
Would you like a drink?
Jamie's teased at school for her uncle being Michael Myers and viciously for being an orphan. Look at this incredible Betty Boop costume. Rachel picks Jamie up with her friend Lindsay Wallace, who was the little girl Lori babysat in the original. They go to pick up Jamie's Halloween costume, and Michael's there as well, I guess, but it's some of it might be in Jamie's imagination, but also he does physically get the mask that he picks up when we see him, so who knows. Haddonfield's funny because this drugstore is 10 years after several killings, still keeping this mask on the shelf. Jamie picks out a clown costume, which is of course what Michael was wearing in 1963 when he killed Judith. While trick-or-treating, Jamie and Rachel get separated because Rachel gets into an argument with this guy she's gone out with a few times who's at the house of the sheriff's daughter. Suspense rises when Jamie and Rachel try to find each other. And Michael's lurking in the night. Meanwhile, Loomis has riled up a group of drunk dads to go after Michael in place of the now dead police force, while Haddonfield waits for state troopers to arrive. They mistakenly identify Michael and shoot and kill the wrong person.
Shit, Earl. It's Ted Hollister.
By the time Jamie and Rachel find each other, the cops show up and everyone converges at the sheriff's house. Michael, for some reason, sneaks his way there by lounging in the back of the deputy's car and then very gradually kills his way through the cops guarding Jamie. The ensuing chase takes us through Jamie's school and then to the road out of Haddonfield, where Michael has snuck into another car. He kills the vigilantes and forces Rachel and Jamie off the road. The state troopers and Sheriff Meeker show up and shoot Michael into a mine shaft.
Get down!
Back at home, Jamie's taken upstairs by her mom to get cleaned up, and like Michael in 1963, we see through her clown mask as she becomes the killer. She appears at the top of the stairs, and Loomis tries to shoot her.
No!
He's stopped by the sheriff, and we end on Jamie. Okay, I take back my earlier claim. Halloween 5 has the best opening. Michael drifts pathetically for a full 30 seconds before pulling himself out of the water and up to the very odd home of this man and his parrot.
Quiet, Sookie.
He tries to kill the man, but faints, and we cut to a full year later, where we see him still living at this guy's place. Take note of this symbol that Michael has on his wrist. It will be important in the next movie. Jamie's waking up at Haddonfield's Children's Clinic after dreaming about the night she stabbed her mom. She can't speak, but Translike writes, "He's coming for me," as Michael puts his mask on and kills his roommate. When Jamie can't breathe, the doctor tries to give her a tracheotomy, but Loomis pops up and stops him. Pretty much every time we see Loomis in this movie is filmed like a jump scare. Jamie's breath comes back, and she's okay the next day when visited by Rachel and her much cooler, more fun friend Tina. A brick is thrown through Jamie's window, but the idea that Haddonfield's scared of her for killing her mom doesn't, like, go anywhere. But it does give us this, my favorite moment of the franchise. Loomis is monitoring Jamie for more Michael news when she starts drawing through his eyes. This kid, Billy, has a stutter but is close with Jamie and does his best to speak for her. Rachel's warned that she needs to get out of their house immediately, and when cops are called to investigate, we find out that this movie has made the incredible cinematic decision to play clown sound effects only when these two are on screen.
All clear.
Nothing above, nothing below.
I'm so embarrassed.
It's what we're here for.
Rescue cats.
Find dogs.
That's a job.
And we love it.
A mysterious man arrives via bus. Michael kills Tina's boyfriend, also named Michael, and steals his car and the Halloween mask that Tina got him. At the Children's Clinic's Goblin Costume Pageant, Jamie realizes that Tina's in danger. When Michael oddly acquiesces to Tina's request that they stop for cigarettes,
"Stop here, I want to pack a cigarette. Psycho boyfriend."
Jamie tries her best to describe where Tina is.
Cookie woman.
The cops swarm before Tina gets back to the car and Michael slips away. Despite Jamie's begging, which in desperation has brought her voice back enough to cry Tina, Tina goes back out to a Halloween party. Oh, I should probably mention that Rachel was killed earlier, but Jamie didn't get any visions of that the way she did for Tina. At the party, the cops are keeping watch and are tricked by Tina's friend who is dressed up like Michael.
She's a virgin.
Got her phone number?
Fortunately, we're lousy cops. Sorry.
The real Michael arrives to pick off the teens, and Jamie and Billy escape from the clinic to help Tina. Michael chases them in a car through a field, and Tina is killed. Loomis lures Michael back to the Myers house.
Michael, go home! Go home! Go to your house!
And uses Jamie as bait. The plan kind of works, and Michael's taken to jail. We see the man with cowboy boots walk into the jail, gun down the cops, and, like, set the jail cell on fire, and while Jamie walks in to investigate, we see that Michael has escaped. There are two pretty different versions of this movie, the theatrical and producer's cuts. I'll pretty much be going through the beats of the producer's cut because story-wise, it is a whole lot clearer. Jamie was, we learn, kidnapped in the closing scene of Halloween 5 and has been held captive by a cult in what I guess is an underground cave system under Smith's Grove. She was impregnated by Michael, and after giving birth, she manages to escape with the baby. Michael in pursuit. Back in Haddonfield, everyone's tuning in to a shock jock radio show hosted by Barry Sims, who's like a fictionalized Howard Stern type.
It's Back Talk with Barry Sims.
We see Kara, the current inhabitant of the Myers house.
Tomorrow night, we will be coming to you from Haddonfield, the town that has banned Halloween since 1989.
Paul Rudd, who's watching her undress from across the street, and Dr. Loomis, who's writing his memoirs. We get the state of things in Haddonfield. Halloween's been banned, and Barry's callers have a lot to say.
Things have changed in the 90s. Gays in the military. Cut off your husband's dude, I'm a national hero. I just can't see any sense in bringing Halloween back to Haddonfield.
Wank, wank. Thank you, Dwayne.
Jamie has stopped at a bus depot, and after failing to get through to the cops, she also calls in to Barry Sims. She asks Loomis for help, leaves her baby in a bathroom locker, and goes back into the night where she's hunted and attacked by Michael. Loomis, troubled by what he heard, returns to Smith's Grove to meet with Dr. Wynn, this guy from the original, where they learn that Jamie's body was found near Haddonfield under a giant symbol, the rune Thorn, which you may remember from Michael's wrist in the last movie. At the Myers house, Kara and her son Danny are living with her parents and brother. Her dad is Lori's dad's brother, so I guess Kara is Michael and Lori's cousin, and Danny is Michael's nephew. Her dad doesn't like that she's come home with a kid, and when their fight at the breakfast table escalates and he slaps her, a voice tells Danny to kill for Michael, and Danny pulls a knife on his grandfather. When Kara, her brother, and his girlfriend head to school, Kara finds out that the man across the street is Tommy Doyle, the kid Lori babysat in the original. He's obsessively listening back to his recording of Jamie's call and realizes he can hear bus announcements in the background. He finds her baby, names it Steven, and takes it to the hospital where he doesn't act weird.
Get me a doctor, now!
Security?
He sees Dr. Loomis. Jamie's alive but on life support, and Tommy asks Loomis to meet him that night at a Bring Back Halloween protest.
Tommy, wait! Wait!
Loomis scares Kara's mom, Tommy scares Danny, and Jamie is assassinated. Kara comes home to find Tommy in Danny's room.
Tommy's my new friend, and he knows all about dinosaurs.
And Tommy takes them across the street to the room he rents from a deaf woman, Mrs. Blankenship. In a fantastic scene, he explains Thorn.
Runes are a kind of early alphabet.
He explains that for the ancient druids, Thorn represented a demon that destroyed crops and spread sickness.
According to Celtic legend, one child from each tribe was chosen to be inflicted with the curse of Thorn, to offer the blood sacrifices of its next of kin on the night of Samhain.
Halloween, why are you so concerned about us if Michael's only out to kill his family?
In his mind, anyone living in his house is his family. For years, I've been convinced there must be some reason, some method behind Michael's madness.
He's also realized that the rune is a constellation that appears on some Halloweens.
Whenever it appears, he appears.
He then leaves them to meet Loomis at the protest hosted by Barry Sims.
I bet she wears crotchless panties and barks like a dog.
Kara's family is systematically murdered by Michael, though he does stop to bring her brother a towel before killing him.
Could you bring a towel in here? I'm freezing. Where are you when I need you, honey?
Which I guess is nice. It turns out Mrs. Blankenship is part of the Cult of Thorn, and Kara and Danny are kidnapped. Loomis and Tommy track them down, and Loomis goes to face Wynn while Tommy wanders the halls with a bag of protective runes. Loomis is knocked out and given Wynn's job, I guess.
Leave him there. It's his office now.
Tommy steals a cult robe and interrupts the ceremony. Our heroes escape, pursued by Michael. Paul Rudd uses his protective runes to stop Michael from following them, which is an incredible scene.
Michael, what have they done to you?
It's only in the producer's cut, but the trade-off is that we lose this also great scene from the theatrical release. Loomis goes back inside to check on things and finds that Michael has swapped clothes with Wynn in some inexplicable subterfuge. Loomis sees the mark of Thorn on his wrist. He screams, and then we end on an In Memory of Donald Pleasance card as he had sadly died during production. Halloween 7, H2O for Halloween 20 years later, because it's 1998 now, is a bit of a reset. It only follows the first two films. Michael and Laurie are still siblings, but unless Michael, like, had Jamie, faked her death, and then ran to California with only a son that we didn't hear anything about, then it only follows two. You can throw out all that Cult of Thorn stuff. The opening itself is reminiscent of those earlier movies. Jamie Lee Curtis, before release, said, "This movie has as much of a feel as the first Halloween movie. Halloween was about walking down a street with the kids, and the way it was told was with such simplicity, and that's exactly what this has." We open on Nurse Marion Chambers coming home and realizing that someone's been in her house. She goes next door where Joseph Gordon-Levitt and friend are playing some driveway hockey. JGL checks out the house for her, gives the all clear, and Marion re-enters, finding her office ransacked. Her framed photo of Dr. Loomis has been knocked over, and her Laurie Strode file is empty. She realizes that Michael's in the house, runs back next door where the kids are already dead, and is killed by Michael in one of the most effective scenes in the franchise. It may actually be my favorite death in the series, but I would have to think about that. Laurie wakes up screaming after a nightmare which foreshadows Michael learning her fake identity and targeting her son John, who's played by Josh Hartnett, who had a very fun year in horror as The Faculty also released in 1998. Laurie doesn't know how to get past her fear of Michael tracking them down and can't let John live his own life. While John has been helping her through her trauma, he doesn't know how they can continue this way. He wants to go on a class trip to Yellowstone, but Laurie, the headmistress of his school, refuses to let him go. A 17th birthday card from his father raises tensions.
Dad, an abusive chain-smoking methadone addict.
Who would attract someone like that?
Ouch.
We cut to the school day where John is dating Molly, played the same year Dawson's Creek came out by Michelle Williams, so not quite the faculty, but still a pretty big year for her as well. John and his friends make a plan to skip the Yellowstone trip and just spend the night with the whole school to themselves. Lori sees Michael everywhere, but is learning to breathe deep and recognize that he's only in her imagination. While everyone's starting their day, Michael is trading in his busted car, stolen from the hockey boys' place, for this very conspicuous one. He leaves the mom and daughter unharmed, only stealing the purse with the car keys, and continues his trek to California. Now, this California school is star-studded. It does not stop at Josh Hartnett and Michelle Williams. We have Janet Leigh, Jamie Lee Curtis's mother. Even for a Halloween movie, we're gonna get a lot of Psycho references in this one. Lori is dating Adam Arkin, son of Alan Arkin, playing Will, the school guidance counselor. And the gate guard is LL Cool J, who spends the movie reading his erotic fiction to his wife over the phone and being way too lenient with dumb teenagers who want to sneak off campus. Lori and boyfriend Will meet for lunch, where we find out Lori is a functioning alcoholic.
Thank you very much.
Lori catches John off campus, and tensions come to a head.
Don't talk to me about responsible, Mom!
I just need this one thing!
Mom, I am not responsible for you! If you want to stay handcuffed to your dead brother, that's fine, but you're not dragging me along.
When they drive back to campus, Michael is right behind them, unnoticed. Taking some time to think about things, Lori realizes that John's right and gives him permission to go to Yellowstone. He still plans to stay on campus with his friends, but now Lori believes that he's left with the other students. Night falls and final checks on the students not going on the trip are done.
I'm having my nipples pierced.
Oh.
After, Will goes to Lori's, who opens up about who she really is.
The girl that... what happened to the sister? She died, right?
In the one part of the movie that I really can't get behind, Lori realizes that Michael must be coming because it's John's 17th birthday and she was 17 when Michael attacked her. When she goes to try to call John, she realizes the phones are down and knows that she's right. Back at school, Michael kills John's two less famous friends while John and Molly run, joining forces with Lori and Will once they arrive. Will accidentally shoots LL Cool J before being killed by Michael. Lori gets the kids to safety and decides she can't keep living like this. She has to face Michael. In the fight, Michael falls, possibly to his death, but before Lori can make sure, LL Cool J pops up, still alive, and carries her out. The police have arrived and Michael is loaded into the coroner's van. Lori can't go back to living in fear, never seeing for herself that Michael is truly dead, so she steals the van as Michael begins waking back up. In the ensuing crash, she is Michael once again at her mercy, and this time she decapitates him. As put by Jamie Lee Curtis, she makes it the choice to redeem or avenge her life. Halloween 8, Resurrection, released in 2002, was basically rewritten by Busta Rhymes to center his own character, which rules. I mean, from like a storytelling point of view, that sucks, but like, it's also very funny. Anyway, we open on a Lori voiceover as we learn that she's now the asylum inmate.
They didn't tell you about Lori Strode?
You must have heard of her.
Sister of Michael Myers?
The man she beheaded at the end of H2O was actually an EMT that Michael had somehow switched places with. Which is like a total bummer after the ending of H2O, but the key to liking Halloween Resurrection is letting go of your attachment to the past and just enjoying this for what it is. Lori has been planning for the day Michael would come for her, and she successfully catches him in a trap. He tricks her into questioning if once again she has the wrong man. She gets in too close, he turns the tables on her, and finally stabs her.
I'll see you in hell.
She falls in a mirror of Michael's original death. Covering his tracks for some reason, Michael hands the bloody knife off to a serial killer-obsessed patient. I truly wonder what the reaction in the theater was like for this very abrupt ending for Laurie Strode, so if you were there, let me know. We move on to Haddonfield University, where we meet our teens, including Starbuck and the guy from Save the Last Dance, which I distinctly remember downloading from Kazaa, probably around the time this movie came out. Our central character, Sarah, spends the movie IMing her online friend, Deckard. He's a chivalrous, I guess.
Knights used to spend their entire lives courting ladies that they would never even touch.
Sarah and her friends have been selected to be on a live-streamed reality TV show where they'll spend the night in the derelict Myers house. The show is run by Busta Rhymes and Tyra Banks. As the kids explore the house, they realize that Busta and Tyra have set designed it with props and fake backstory for Michael. But when one teen gets too close to what she thinks is a dead rat prop in a walled-off subsection of the house, we realize that Michael's been living in the bowels of his childhood home for the last 20 years. He hunts the teens while the show's viewers watch, thinking it's all fake. Deckard, at a Halloween party where he and his friend have a very cool and not weird Pulp Fiction costume, realizes that Sarah's in trouble and begins messaging her instructions one letter at a time. With Deckard's help and Busta's kung fu, the two of them manage to defeat Michael and survive the night.
Michael Myers is not a soundbite, spinoff, tie-in, kind of celebrity scandal. Michael Myers is a killer shark, baggy-ass overalls.
Halloween's 9 and 10 are Rob Zombie's take on the franchise. 9, simply Halloween, was released in 2007 and doesn't follow even the first movie. It starts all the way back at the beginning. Michael is a not-silent kid with a shitty stepdad who disrespects his mom and sister Judith. At school, he's bullied by kids who found out that his mom's a stripper. He mutilates animals and takes photos of their dead bodies. He snaps, killing his bullies, his sister, her boyfriend, and his stepdad. His infant sister and his mom are not killed. He ends up at Smith's Grove in the care of Dr. Loomis. His mother visits, and Michael's responsive for a while, but eventually disappears behind masks he makes himself.
Take it off. It hides my ugliness.
He loses it one day after she brings in a photo of him and his baby sister. We cut to his mom crying on the couch, watching home video of Michael and shooting herself with the sound of the baby crying in the background. Sharon Moon Zombie is pretty effective as Michael's mom, and she makes this otherwise kind of over-the-top scene feel pretty grounded and hard to watch. In this Halloween, we're reminded that Michael is a child and things could have been different. At Smith's Grove, Michael grows up, his case is closed, and he escapes one day, going home for the kitchen knife he hid under the floorboards. Michael stalks Lori, who was his baby sister but has now been adopted, and tries to show her the photo of them as children. She doesn't understand and stabs him. In the struggle, they both go over the railing and Lori shoots Michael. Zombies Halloween 2, released in 2009, or Our Halloween 10, picks up the same night, but we first get a flashback of Michael as a kid at Smith's Grove, where his mom brings him a statue of a white horse. Lori wanders the streets, bloody and traumatized, until Sheriff Brackett, this time played by Brad Dourif, finds her. Depending on the version you watch, the theatrical or director's cut, there's a question of how much of this movie happens in Lori's dreams. The basic story has Lori living with the Bracketts as she and Annie try to move on from the attack. Annie's played by Danielle Harris, who was Jamie Lloyd in parts 4 and 5. Loomis is writing a book on Michael. Michael is following the instructions of his ghost mom to reunite the family. Which I like, but I think I like it because it's more Friday the 13th than Halloween? Honestly, the plot of this movie always kind of gets away from me, but it's got some visuals that I really do like, and those are what stick. Zombies movies tend to get criticized for being too music video-y, among other things. But music videos are probably my favorite form of art, so I don't mind a visual-heavy fever dream of a movie. Basically, Michael and Lori face off, and Lori comes out wearing Michael's mask. We end on her as the patient, smiling at her ghost mommy and the white horse. The current iteration of movies comes from David Gordon Green and Danny McBride. They released Halloween in 2018, which is a sequel only to the first movie. Halloween Kills came out last year after being delayed by COVID. And then this fall, Halloween Ends is going to be the series finale and will come out in October. Halloween 2018 opens on Smith's Grove, where two true crime podcasters are visiting for a story they're doing on Michael. His doctor, Sartain, was a student of Loomis's and is against Michael's impending transfer to prison where he won't be treated as well as he is at Smith's Grove. The podcasters have brought Michael's mask, hoping to get a response out of him. He doesn't really react, but the other inmates freak out when the mask is shown. The podcasters hit up Lori next, who's living in a gated compound and only lets them in when they offer her money for her story. They don't get much out of her.
I believe there's a lot to learn from the horrors you experienced.
There's nothing to learn. There are no new insights or discoveries.
We meet Lori's family, her daughter Karen, played by Judy Greer, and her granddaughter Allison, played by Andy Matichek. We also meet her son-in-law.
Man, I got peanut butter on my penis.
We learn that Lori is estranged from her family, and we meet the dumb teens Allison is friends with. learning along the way that this movie follows only the original.
Wasn't it her brother who, like, cold-blooded murderated all those teenagers?
That's just a bit that some people made up to make him feel better, I think.
The night of Michael's transfer, Lori sits in her car outside the facility drinking and holding a gun as she watches him go. After, she crashes her granddaughter's dinner in a truly heartbreaking scene that hits an emotional realism, which, for the things I dislike about this movie and Halloween Kills, draws me in with an immediate reminder of how much I do love this character and Jamie Lee Curtis. Unfortunately, I don't think this movie or the next ever really recaptures this level of realism. Meanwhile, a young kid and his father are having a very sweet conversation.
I'm missing dance class for this, and sometimes I'd rather do that than hunt him.
Is dance class that important to you?
Sure. On weekends, I'll do it with you, Dad. Like, I really love spending time with you, but right now, dancing is my thing, you know, and it really hits me in the heart.
When they unfortunately come across Michael's crashed prison bus and become his next victims. Sartain, Michael's doctor, is the only survivor at the scene. Back in Haddonfield, the cops start putting together what happened.
Michael Myers loose with a bunch of nutbags in Haddonfield on Halloween night? We're gonna have a fucking circus on our hands.
Michael follows the podcasters from his sister's grave to a gas station where he picks up his preferred outfit, kills the nosy podcasters, and takes back his mask. Lori's mixing strawberry milk when she hears the news about the crashed bus, and she tests the hidden basement under her countertops. Lori tries to warn her family, but they will not believe her that Michael's back. At the Halloween dance, Allison's boyfriend Cameron cheats on her, tells her she's crazy, and then throws her phone in some super goopy-looking drinks so that she'll be incommunicado for the rest of the movie. Meanwhile, her friends are babysitting a very charismatic child when Michael kills them off. Officer Hawkins investigates and runs into Lori. She's introduced to Sartain, who's very excited to meet her. Allison walks home with Cameron's friend, who hits on her.
Their beautiful bodies got me all chubbed out, Allison.
And then dies under motion sensors.
I'm not trying to trespass on your yard. I thought that she liked me too. Have you ever really liked a girl and you just couldn't have her?
This echoes several points from the franchise. I always like when they unknowingly talk to Michael. It's fun. Allison finds the body, sees Michael, and runs for help. Lori, Karen, and her dad prepare at Lori's while the cops and Sartain pick up Allison, who is able to use a neighbor's phone. So I guess the whole cell phone thing didn't really last very long. Unfortunately for Allison, Sartain was never on her side. When they see Michael on the street, Hawkins runs him over and Sartain stabs Hawkins and leaves him to die, pulling Michael into the car and locking Allison in the back seat with his unconscious body.
Most important opportunity to understand the mind of evil, you see.
He orchestrated Michael's escape on the prison bus and wants to take Michael to Lori's to reunite them.
I would suspect the notion of being a predator or the fear of becoming prey keeps both of them alive.
Unfortunately for Sartain, Michael has his own plans, and when he comes to, he kills the doctor and Allison escapes to the woods and runs to Lori's. Michael also heads over there, kills the dad, and falls into Lori and Karen's trap, becoming locked in the burning basement. Lori's house burns as she, her daughter, and her granddaughter escape on a passing pickup truck. Halloween Kills starts with Cameron's dejected walk home from the dance. He finds Hawkins barely alive, and we enter what seems like a flashback, though it'll move off into someone else's memory, so I'm not really sure what to call it. We go back to Halloween night, 1978. Young Hawkins and his partner McCabe are walking through Haddonfield searching for Michael. We get the first of many summaries of Halloween 1978.
He was just killed his sister when he was 6 years old.
Yeah.
And McCabe provides the first Michael lore that these new movies have offered.
My mom used to make me go over to his house to play. It felt bad. But he would just spend the whole time staring out of his sister's bedroom window. The hell was he looking at up there?
He's looking at Haddonfield, a simple town where nothing exciting ever happens.
The two men consider the change coming over their town. We move on to Lonnie Elam's version of the night. He's being bullied when the cops pass by and tell everyone to go home. Lonnie's chased down by Michael and is face to face with him for the second time that day. He apologizes for tripping Tommy earlier, which is odd, and then the cops are there and Michael's gone. They realize where they are, outside of the Myers house, and venture inside. Considering the aforementioned window, McCabe is caught unawares and grabbed by Michael. Hawkins tries to shoot Michael and gets McCabe in the neck instead. Michael walks downstairs into the waiting arms of Loomis and a bunch of cops, and Hawkins claims that Michael killed McCabe.
Did Michael kill again?
Back in the present, we enter Mick's Bar and Takeout, where the people of Haddonfield are celebrating Halloween with a costumed open mic night. There are some loud people sitting behind a costumed couple we got a glance of leaving their house in Halloween 2018. Nurse dressed as Dr. Marcus, and doctor dressed as Nurse Vanessa. These are the new characters we start the movie with. Unfortunately, they're not very well served by the story. When Marcus gets up to get more drinks, the bartender gives us our second recap of Halloween 1978.
That crazy lady that almost got killed by Michael Myers.
Laura Stokes or something.
Laura Stokes, the one that survived Michael Myers.
I was really excited to see where this costume talent show was gonna go, but unfortunately Tommy Doyle takes the stage and kills the mood quickly with our next recap of Halloween 1978.
40 years ago, a madman escaped from a mental hospital. Three teenage girls were walking home from Haddonfield High. A ghost-like figure, man in a white mask who had a power beyond any mortal man.
He's played by Anthony Michael Hall, star of some of my least favorite movies, and lets us know that the row behind Vanessa and Marcus is actually a bunch of people we know. He was brought on stage by adult Lonnie Elam and sits with nurse Marion Chambers and Lindsay Wallace. It seems odd that this crowd would need the exposition here, but okay. He ends on a cheers to Lori.
Wherever you are!
And we cut to the pickup trucks passing fire trucks that are heading back to Lori's place. It turns out Michael was hiding behind like a metal garage door in the basement and was safe from the fire the whole time, which is super lame. Anyway, he kills the first responders. Lori, Karen, and Allison are at the hospital. Lori undergoes surgery, which is actually pretty cool. And Karen and Allison process the loss of their husband, father. Michael makes his way to Haddonfield and news starts to spread. Two Smiths Grove inmates are reported as missing from the crash site, and Tommy Doyle starts to lose his mind on a quest to finally face off against Michael as the protector rather than the protected. There's a man in Vanessa and Marcus's car when they try to leave the bar, and Tommy becomes convinced that it's Michael, who we do know does like to hide in cars, so fair enough.
Tommy, what are you doing?
Love lives today.
But evil dies tonight.
The obviously not Michael drives the car into a pole and escapes, leaving behind an umbrella. We meet the current inhabitants of the Myers house, Big and Little John. Characters I have very mixed feelings about because while I really like them, their relationship is definitely being played for laughs.
Big John?
Yes, Little John.
Which would be less off-putting if these weren't the only queer characters in about 45 years of this franchise. They get pranked by some kids and warn them that Michael will come after them, giving us yet another summary of who Michael Myers is, though my favorite so far.
Do you have any idea whose house this was?
No.
You ever hear of Michael fucking Myers? He stabbed his sister in the tits.
Yuck.
I mean, it is brave to make a movie that claims that this whole town is defined by and traumatized by Michael Myers, and then have no one in the town actually know who he is. Back at the hospital, we get the most nonsensical argument I've ever heard.
I want you to go and sit in grandmother's room and wait there until she wakes up.
We're gonna go after him, we're gonna find Michael.
I'm going with them. No, he is on his way here. He is stalking her, and we are staying here to protect
her. He's infected your family, he's infected my family with grief and fear for 40 years.
I'm not gonna pretend this didn't happen. You think you're the one that's gonna find him? Sit in that room and wait with your grandmother.
The boogeyman is at large. He is an apex predator. Evil dies tonight!
Evil dies tonight!
Evil dies tonight!
Michael hunts down Vanessa, Marcus, Marion, and Lindsay, though Lindsay survives by pretending to be Frodo escaping the Shire. Allison, Cameron, and Lonnie realize that Michael will be heading home.
He creeps, he kills, he goes home.
And reach the Myers house after Big and Little John have been killed.
You've come home.
The second escapee of the Smiths Grove transfer bus wanders into the hospital. He is immediately mistaken for Michael.
Evil dies tonight!
And Tommy Doyle and his mission to become the protector that Lori was to him riles everyone up and they mob him. He's cornered in a top floor hallway where he breaks the window and jumps to his death. The crowd realizes their mistake and we move on. This scene is cut with the admission by Hawkins to Lori that he had the chance to kill Michael Halloween night, 1978. Ignoring the ridiculousness of every moment of this situation and Hawkins ensuing character motivation because he wouldn't have been able to kill Michael anyway and Michael would have definitely just killed McCabe. We watch Hawkins flashback to him then covering up the shooting of his partner. Lori decides it's on her to kill Michael. Cameron and Lonnie die in the Myers house, but Allison is saved when Karen shows up in time to stab Michael with a pitchfork.
I'm an innocent woman.
just like your sister was.
The town comes together to kill Michael. Karen checks out the famous window. Michael kills the town and then sneaks up on Karen, killing her. Lori senses what has happened and heads for Michael. So that catches us up to now, where we're all awaiting the release of Halloween Ends October 14th. Okay, thank you for watching. If you are currently watching, that also means that I actually finished and posted the video, which is very cool because I don't know how to finish anything and I've never done anything like this before, and it was very fun, but hopefully will be better next time because I learned a lot of things along the way, I think. Part two, which is like the actual essay and not just the recap that I kind of put together as a introduction to the essay, will be out sometime between now and October 14th when the new movie comes out. And then after that, probably just whatever thing I can't stop talking to my friends about and that they get sick of hearing about, which is why I wrote the Halloween essay in the first place, because I was so bothered by Halloween kills and I couldn't figure out exactly why. So then I ended up making these videos to try to figure that out, I guess. But then it turned into something else, so who knows. There'll probably be a lot of history because I've studied and written a lot about history and movies, probably some hockey. The season's about to start and I'm already doing nothing but listening to hockey podcasts and watching highlights, and yeah. So, alright, so yeah, if you liked this video or if any of that sounds good, please like and subscribe, and I'll see you soon. Bye!